Hello and welcome to the 88th session in the AI Safety Reading Group. Tonight we'll be discussing the article The Ethics of Artificial Intelligence by Eliezer Yudkowsky and Nick Bostrom. Eliezer Yudkowsky is one of the two founders of the modern AI safety field. He's also the founder of the Machine Intelligence Research Institute. Nick Bostrom is the other founder of modern AI safety. And he is also the founder of the Future of Humanity Institute. So these two are probably the two key people in AI safety. The article is called The Ethics of Artificial Intelligence, and it's a chapter in the Cambridge Handbook of Artificial Intelligence, published in 2014. Now, if you would think of examples of ethical problems in narrow AI, two examples that would come to mind are a very publicized problem with an AI system that classified white people as low risk of reoffending after having been in prison, and black people as high risk of reoffending. This bias was built into the narrow AI system that looked into whether they should be allowed probation. Another example is the problem that many algorithms can be manipulated. The image to the left is guacamole, according to one artificial intelligence image classifier, and the image on the right is a cat, even though a human would not be in doubt at all that both are cats. Now, these two are from 2016 and 2015, these two examples, but somewhat presciently, the article describes these two exact problems as motivating examples of ethical problems in narrow AI. Narrow AI has a number of ethical issues. There are issues of responsibility, transparency, auditability, incorruptibility, predictability, and a number of others. These are, of course, important, but somewhat less important for artificial intelligence compared to everything else. This is also important for dishwashers or cars or things like that. Artificial general intelligence, however, possesses some rather new challenges. You can look at it as I've tried to set up a table with the predictability of narrow AI versus general AI, both whether they can be predicted in a local sense, like what is the next step the AI will do, whether it can be evaluated, like is this a good step or not, the next step, whether it's trying to do what its global goal is, whether that can be predicted, and whether it can be evaluated. Now, for narrow AI, we obviously cannot predict its next step. That's the reason why we implement artificial intelligence, because we cannot give simple rules for what it should do. We can, however, evaluate it. If it's a chess algorithm, we will be able to see if it's winning or not in the moment. Now, the global state, we can obviously predict that our narrow AI will be trying to win. And we can as well evaluate whether that is good or bad. For general artificial intelligence, this changes. We can still not predict what it's going to do, and we can no longer evaluate whether the steps it's taking are likely to bring us towards a good goal. We cannot even predict in a global sense which solution the artificial general intelligence is trying to reach. And this means that specifying that it is taking safe solutions, that it's doing safe things, is really, really hard. And that is a key ethical problem. We can, however, still evaluate the global effects of this artificial general intelligence. The problem is that artificial general intelligence will operate in new contexts that we cannot predict and cannot ensure that they are safe. So the purpose of the narrow AI is something that is written in the designer's mind. The chess algorithm doesn't know that it's supposed to win chess. That's something the human specifying it knows. Whereas a general AI, in order to behave in an ethical way, the goal must be represented in the general AI, and it must be doing it in an ethical way, like an ethical engineer, and not as a product of an ethical engineer. Another issue for the ethics of artificial intelligence is whether the algorithms will have moral status. We say that something have moral status if it counts in its own right, and it's permissible to do something for its own sake. The current AI systems we have are clearly not moral systems. They don't have moral status. The two criteria that they are missing are sentience, something like qualia, and sapience, self-awareness, basically. If we later get artificial general intelligences that are both sentient and sapient, they will probably have full moral status, or we should probably afford them full moral status. This requires two principles to be accepted: the substrate non-discrimination principle, that if the functionality is the same, but they are implemented in silicium instead of a wet brain matter, that doesn't really matter. And where they come from, the ontogeny non-discrimination principle, that if they are built in a lab or copied from someone else, doesn't really matter compared to what matters if whether they have the same functionality and conscious experience. So, is these two requirements, sentience and sapience, is it possible to have sentience without sapience? We obviously see animals that appear to be sentient but not sapient, but the other way around might be possible. It might be possible to have algorithms that are extremely sophisticated but do not have qualia. Maybe. It's unclear. Qualia is not something that has been resolved by professional philosophers. So the problem is, these kind of artificial intelligence, should we give them moral status as humans or something like that? This can be related to the well-known philosophical problem of pea zombies, philosophical zombies, where quite a lot have been written about those, but mostly the focus has been on whether it's possible compared to whether they should have moral status. And the pea zombies thought experiment requires that they have the same substrate, which is, of course, very different for an artificial intelligence. Another issue of the ethics of artificial intelligence is that time may pass in a different rate for an artificial intelligence compared to humans. For things like prison or pain, the duration of the prison or the duration of the pain matters a lot. And should we then measure that in objective or subjective time? Ilya Yudkowsky and Nick Bostrom suggests the principle of subjective rate of time, that it's the subjective duration that counts. There is also the problem of reproductive freedom, which is considered very important in ethics right now. And clearly, this must be rethought, as an artificial intelligence might be able to reproduce just by means of copying a program, which could happen really quickly. And if we want to have a social safety net of some kind, then this will be very problematic. These kind of problems with reproductive freedom are what can be called intermediate level ethics. And a major conclusion of the paper is that when thinking about ethics in unfamiliar context, do not mistake mid-level ethical principles for foundational normative truths. When it comes to superintelligence, the ethical challenges are very, very different from what we have seen so far. We are going from ethical actions having consequences mostly on the individual scale to having global or even cosmic scale consequences. These consequences can, of course, be both very, very negative and very, very positive. One of the problems with the superintelligence is that it might have very different morals from us, and compared to the ancient Greeks, who also who thought a lot about ethics But still weren't able to conclude that slavery was ethically problematic in the way that it is very clear from us. And so a superintelligence might have ethics that are quite different from ours. However, if we try to implement our ethics into the superintelligence, that would probably be a tragedy. Even if superior ethics would be a tragedy if they are stable, if there is no room for growth in the ethics, if the superintelligence has hard-coded ethics. So the main problem is to build an AI which becomes more ethical than you gradually by learning things about the world, doing what philosopher does, basically. And we should certainly not try to invent a super ethics, trying to extrapolate in a naive way the ethics that we have into a super version. But we need to find a solution. And this is a challenge that we need to meet, and we need to have it ready before we have the first super intelligence. Thank you for watching, and see you.